For this reaction of acetylene and hydrogen, we're going to try to set up a Langmuir-Hinshelwood mechanism and see if we can explain some of the data, the kinetic data that we got that way, and just a useful exercise in seeing how Langmuir-Hinshelwood works. And so we're, in a general case, you have to, we'll often have to decide what you're going to assume, and you have to test different models to see if they work. Here, we're actually, for definiteness, we're told in the problem statement what we should try. All right, and that's that there are four different key steps. Right, the first step is reversible adsorption of acetylene. Second step is reversible but dissociative adsorption of hydrogen. And the third step is an irreversible rate-determining reaction of adsorbed acetylene with hydrogen to produce ethylene or a form of ethylene on the surface. And then the final step is a reversible reaction of adsorbed ethylene with another hydrogen atom to make gas phase ethylene and free up the vacant surface sites that were occupied. Okay, so we're going to test this out. And to do Langmuir-Hinshelwood, we basically take each of the steps in sequence and write a relationship that helps us describe that step. All right, so if this step is rate determining and all the other steps are reversible, okay, then we will assume that those other steps are at equilibrium. And so we can start with step one, and we can write an equilibrium expression for it. All right, so the equilibrium expression, as is said in the problem statement here, we'll write in terms of K sub 1, right, and that's equal to, I'll use concentration of A, S here for concentration of A on the surface, is equal to the concentration of A on the surface divided by the concentration of vacant sites and the partial pressure of A. All right, so concentration of products over reactants here for our equilibrium expression. And we can rearrange this into a form that's going to be useful later. We're going to want to be able to isolate our surface species. The concentration of A is therefore equal to this K1PA, concentration of vacant sites. Okay, so K2 is equal to, again, reactants over products, so CHS squared, because we formed two of them, over the concentration of vacant sites squared and the partial pressure of hydrogen. And we can solve again for the concentration of the surface species, HS, and that's equal to the square root of K2, partial pressure of hydrogen, and concentration of vacant sites. Okay, we'll skip 3 because it's not a reversible step, and we'll do K4 next. Okay, so K4, we're going to describe in terms of the adsorption process as being the forward process by convention, although it won't affect the basic result of the problem if you do it the other way. We express the equilibrium constant for adsorption. All right, so the adsorbed species represent the products, even though they're written as the reactants here. And again, this doesn't really affect the solution to the problem very much, except that we will invert our K4 eventually, as we'll see. All right, so then the concentration of the form of ethylene that's adsorbed on the surface, which is basically missing a hydrogen, is going to be equal to K4 times P, the pressure of ethylene, times the concentration of vacant sites squared, divided by the concentration of sites that are occupied by hydrogen. And here I'm going to look ahead a little bit. All right, and we'll see why this is useful later. It's going to be useful to eliminate. It's going to be useful to eliminate the concentration of hydrogen on the surface here, and so we can plug in this expression right here, and it's going to actually simplify things a little bit. And so we'll get K4, partial pressure of ethylene, over square root of K2, partial pressure of hydrogen. And then we actually lose one of our concentrations of vacant sites as part of that, which is going to help us later. Okay, so now we've expressed the concentrations for all of our bound species in terms of the concentration of vacant sites and in terms of these equilibrium constants and partial pressures. Now we step to the next phase of a Langmuir-Hinshelwood type problem, which is for the rate determining step, which is number 3. All right, and this is an irreversible step as defined in the problem statement. So the rate is equal to the rate constant for 3 times the concentration of acetylene that's bound to the surface times the concentration of hydrogen that's bound to the surface. And so we can just plug those values in. So it's going to be equal to this term comes from the concentration of acetylene. This term comes from the concentration of hydrogen. And each one, if we look above, contributes a concentration of vacant sites. When we multiply those two together, we get a square term. All right, so all of these are either parameters that are dependent on temperature, which are these Ks, or partial pressures, or this concentration of vacant sites, which we don't have a relationship for. We need to eliminate that. All right, but fortunately, we have a way to do that, which is the site balance. Okay, and so the site balance in this case says that the total concentration of sites is equal to the concentration of vacant sites plus the concentration of sites that have acetylene plus the concentration of sites that have hydrogen plus the concentration of sites that have ethylene. And we have all of those, we have expressions for all of those, and it turns out that all of them have a concentration of vacant sites to the first power in it. And I'll just go ahead and fill those in quickly. And I went ahead and wrote out several complicated expressions here. All right, but we can determine the concentration of total sites in terms of the concentration of vacant sites. And the sum of terms that includes only adsorption equilibrium constants and partial pressures, which are measurable values. And then we can just divide through both sides of the equation by the terms in brackets to solve for CV and plug that value for CV right here, which leads to this final equation for the rate of reaction, which is a bunch of rate constants and equilibrium constants here, first order dependence on acetylene, half order dependence on hydrogen in the numerator, the squared dependence on the total concentration of sites, which isn't necessarily known, but should be constant for a given amount of catalyst and would usually scale with the amount of catalyst. Right, and then all of this term in the denominator that has to do with the availability of vacant sites, sites that have acetylene on them, sites that have hydrogen on them, and sites that have this dehydrogenated form of ethylene on them. Right? And whichever term is the largest among those terms. So let's say that this term ended up having the largest magnitude. That would indicate that more of the sites have acetylene than any other type of species, for example. Okay, but we've now solved for this expression, and it was a complicated one, so not so annoying algebra. But we can compare our derived Langmuir-Hinshelwood expression to the data in part A, and is this expression potentially consistent with the data? It turns out that it's not. If we back up all the way to A, then we see that we determined that the rate was equal to a zeroth order dependence and a first order on acetylene and a first order dependence, hydrogen. And it's the latter that's not possible. So let me write out again here what was actually found in a very simplified way, that we would have some rate constant K that can be a lumped grouping of these terms times the partial pressure of hydrogen to the first power. Okay, here we see we only have a concentration of hydrogen to the half power, so it appears unlikely that we'd be able to get this first order kind of dependence, but it's actually not impossible. So let's say, for example, that this is the most important term in the denominator because the surface is just dominated by ethylene coverage. All right, if that's the case, then we have this hydrogen in the denominator of this expression that we're taking the square root of, but that's being squared, and so we have potentially an up to first order dependence of hydrogen that can be in the numerator. You can have a much higher than half order dependence of hydrogen if you're in the right regime of surface coverage such that ethylene is dominating. If, on the other hand, in order to have the acetylene reaction order be zero, as was observed in the data, then this term would definitely have to be important. That it couldn't be negligible because you would need to decrease the first order dependence that's in the numerator with some kind of dependence in the denominator on the partial pressure of A. And so this suggests that you could potentially have two terms that were important, which would be in this term, so a surface that's largely covered by acetylene and ethylene components that just happen to balance out so that you have an overall dependence of A of zero order and overall dependence on hydrogen or first order. And so that's not very likely. It doesn't look like this mechanism is likely to be consistent, but it's actually not impossible just from inspection that that would be the case, that you could have a significant coverage of those two species that balance out to give you a very weak dependence on acetylene and a strong dependence, a stronger dependence on hydrogen.